I want to call upon Hareesh Tibrewala, Joint CEO of Mirum India, to conduct the panel discussion. Hareesh will be moderating. Hareesh, over to you.
We have a very interesting panel this evening, and I'd like to invite our panelists to the stage. Let me start by inviting Nitin Singhal. Nitin Singhal is a veteran in the IT industry, more than two decades of experience, been with very large companies, and now he's heading one of the largest verticals in Salesforce as the Area Vice President in India. Welcome Nitin. My next guest for the evening is Ashok Venkatramani. Ashok was leading Unilever for a number of years and managing the skin and soap business, 5,000 crore of portfolio, and thereafter was CEO with ABB and is currently Managing Director of Zee Media. Welcome, Ashok. My next guest for the evening is Jaibeer. Jaibeer has been with JWT for a number of years, was leading the Pepsi business, and is now with Cheil Worldwide. Welcome, Jaibeer. Then I have Biswadeep Sahoo. Biswadeep Sahoo leads digital transformation at Hero FinCorp in the IT department. Welcome, Biswadeep. And my last guest is Sanjay Mehta, my friend as well as co-founder at Mirum India, which is a digital agency. So welcome Sanjay, welcome onto the panel. So one interesting secret I must let out on this panel. There are three people on this panel who have known each other for 35 years now. At the end of this discussion, see if we can figure out who are those three people. We'll have like a 30-minute panel discussion. I will address some questions to the panelists, try to get their views on this question. Then we have like a 5-minute fun round. We'll have some quick fun. And then we'll open it for questions in the audience. I know Ashok is in a hurry. He needs to leave. So in case at some point of time you need to leave, we'll be okay with that, Ashok. Let me start with my favorite question, which is about data-driven marketing. You know, we live in a world of data-driven marketing. So does it mean creativity is dead? Ashok, let's start with you. Is creativity no longer important? You have been in the consumer side of business. You have been in the media side. Is this creativity no longer important?
You know, Hareesh, first of all, thank you, Hareesh, for inviting me over. You know, I belong to an age and an industry where we are sitting and debating, is the future of marketing in digital marketing? And then I get invited to a session where the future of digital marketing itself is being discussed. So I'm a very strong believer in the old school of marketing, because I still believe that close to 85-90% of India's marketing monies are still spent in traditional media. Digital media is good, fun, sexy, but that's not serious way of building marketing brands. That's my view, okay, and I hold that view very strongly. A lot of discussion which keeps happening, incidentally, I also run a digital business, so it's right. Not that I'm alien to digital, or I have an antipathy to digital. But having built brands all my life, I think a lot of work which is happening, or evolution which is happening in the digital marketing space, is largely focused on the pipe. Yeah, the way to reach the consumer in the most efficient and cost efficient way. There is no conversation which is happening on the content, which is really about, okay, you reach the consumer in the best possible, and then what? You reached me, a brand which wants to reach me has reached me in the most efficient way. It's there sitting on my mobile phone. So it's reached me. Mm-hmm. And what? Then what? The what is the answer which is usually given by, finally, what is it that you're going to communicate? And how is it you're going to communicate? Now, there are various ways in which this actually gets explained. One way is pipe versus content. And that's a language which a lot of people in this audience will probably understand. Let me explain it in a very traditional way, which is heart versus mind. So a lot of digital marketing is all about mind talk, you know, efficiency. No, it's not talking about the heart. And I think brands are actually built when you touch the heart and not touch the mind. Another way in which it is explained, which is right brain versus left brain. A lot of digital marketing, or a lot of conversation which happens, mathematics, analytics, is all about, you know, left brain approach to marketing. Whereas real brands actually get built when you actually touch the right brain, not necessarily the left brain. They're important. I'm not saying that it's an either or. Left brain is important. You need to reach consumers efficiently. You need to bring in efficiency in the way marketing monies are spent. But it's finally about the content. It's finally about the what. What do you tell the consumer? And how effectively are you able to connect, emote with the consumer? Because that's what finally builds the brand. No disrespect meant to any of the people or any of the charts which were presented. But, you know, in all the presentations which I ran over the last 45 minutes, there were a number of client names which were written on the right side. Not one of them is a brand. If somebody seriously believes that they are going to build a brand using Facebook or Instagram, I mean, you must be, I mean, are you serious? Is that what my only
question? So, so what I hear from you is that you really believe creativity is very much alive and kicking. And that is the way that one needs to kind of use.
Not only that, and I'm just saying that the let me come back to the topic. If you know, the future of digital marketing will be alive and kicking only if they find a creative way of reaching the heart,
sure,
and not necessarily the mind. And I'm just saying that unless that is done, traditional marketing won't die. Content won't die. You take evolved markets where digital market is thriving. It's thriving, but it's not killed traditional marketing. And the reason for that is that digital marketing is still talking about efficiency with an effectiveness of reaching the right consumer.
Right.
But it's not talking about the how the connect, the emotional connect is going to be built.
Jaibeer, what is your opinion? You come from a creative agency and now with Cheil, which is like an integrated agency. So
yeah, well,
do you endorse what Venkat has to say?
First of all, you know, when I came into this room, I felt like a dinosaur. Because, you know, I've spent 18, 19 years in advertising, ATL advertising, on brands which have been predominantly on, as so said, on the traditional media. And I completely agree with him. Creativity is not going to die. The way brands are built, they have to appeal to the heart. Having said that, the complexity has changed. It's not a very linear way we are interacting with the consumer today. It's become far more complex, the matrix now. Mm-hmm. So you can't just be on one medium trying to reach him only and bombarding him with one messaging. You have to find a way to connect with him in that matrix. He's interacting with brands. We are interacting with him at so many multiple touch points. How do you engage him there? How do you, the challenge is bigger for creativity. It's not just one message or one way to communicate it. You have to make it more specific. You have to make it more contextual. How do you engage him there? So it is a bigger challenge for creativity, but creativity is going to thrive there because ultimately, as I said, it is how you appeal to the heart.
So what I understand from you is creativity is very important, but those data points are becoming more relevant to reach out to the right
absolutely,
person.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Sanjay, you run a digital agency. I mean, what is your view when you go to a client pitch? Are you leading with creativity or with data? And don't say both.
No, I think it's a very interesting conversation, and I think Ashok and Jaibeer have made some important points. I completely agree at the fundamental level with Ashok, where the heart is an important element of the, you know, the conviction, convincing your consumer. But let's look at the change which has happened over the years. So now suddenly you have a means of being extremely sharply targeted, right? So earlier, perhaps in the days when, you know, with due respect, when Ashok was building the skincare brands, you know, maybe a decade back or something like that, you know, yes, television was a premium medium, and even though digital might have existed, the ability to sharply reach a very specific consumer was limited. So now we have the efficiency of the medium, and yet you still have the need to reach the heart. When it was television, you didn't have a choice, and you came up with this one storyboard or one creative idea, and so you put your best creative minds and your best planners and came up with this beautiful advertisement or something, and you know, you did what best you could do. One size fits all was generally the way to go. Now you have the ability to slice it down 1,000 ways and be very specific to the urban housewife of, you know, 45 to 55 years who's doing this, you know, a certain message to somebody in a different geography or a different demography, a different message, all that ability is there. Now, yes, the ideal way would be to have amazing creativity individually delivered to all of them. But the kind of creative resource and time and effort which would be required to deliver that would make it extremely inefficient, because there are only so many great creative minds who can deliver so many creative output. So then you have to see, how do you marry the creative process and this efficiency of being able to do sharply divided campaigns? So that's where the ability of the technology comes in, the digital technology, where, say, for example, you could have 20 or 30 or 100 variants of a creative ideation being delivered in the most relevant manner to the right audience. Now, that's the digital technology piece, riding on the shoulders of a good original creative idea. So the way they are actually being delivered is the intersection. But you can't be doing, you know, the big creative head of an agency can't be creating 1,000 variants, because that kind of, you know, that just would not make efficiency in terms of cost. So you take that and then find a way for technology. Like, for example, most of our abilities or the Salesforce, you know, engine will allow you to cut and paste different elements of a creative. You know, like, there's this classic case where a brand would be delivering an email in one shot to about 12 million email recipients, but there are 6 million variants of the email going out, which means that no more than 2 people are receiving the same email. Now, email has a lot of creative elements to it, but the fact that it has been sliced and diced and the creative has been changed and communication has been changed to make the most sense is how technology is taking over on top of the original creative idea. So that's where the opportunities, and that's what it's being delivered. So that's what I would lead with in terms of answering your question.
Interesting. So you heard like 3 different perspectives on this creativity versus digital kind of a thing. Let's get Nitin into the conversation, Nitin. We keep using the word digital transformation, and everybody has a different definition for digital transformation. In your opinion, what is real digital transformation?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Hareesh. So one comment I wanted to make on this topic, which had an interesting perspective. You know, in the late 80s, the only source of getting to know about what's happening in the media and advertising world was a magazine called A&M. I don't know how many people saw it. But, you know, marketing is a very evolved subject. I think digital transformation is a very large, you know, aspect of what customers want to do. But I completely agree with, you know, Ashok, that creativity, you know, the first aspect of reaching out to your customers, reaching out to your prospects, is being creative about how you want to go ahead and sell your services and products, right? There's no replacement for that. And that's one of the reasons why I see the trend that, you know, creative marketing organizations have actually acquired technology companies, not the other way around. You know, so that's the aspect. I agree that you can't build brands. In the early 90s, right, Piyush Pandey was one of my, you know, favorite persons to actually go lead the creative aspect of it. And he's talked about the same thing, that it should touch your heart. Even today, when I run sales, when we go do campaigns, you know, the campaign's got to basically solve a challenge for our prospect. It's basically saying the same thing in a little more technical way that, you know, what's the challenge of a salesperson? What's the challenge of a service person? It's touching him, it's solving his challenge, making him go easy on, you know, what he does in a day-to-day work. And the ability to do this creatively, but have a technology follow through, which means that there's so many people out here, right? We have technology today to actually get to know your behavior, get to know what's happening, what are you searching for, and then reach out to you. That's the technology that's in. And if we don't do that today, you know, you yourself are connected on 5 devices, you're connected on 3 devices, you're connected to Alexa, you're connected to OTT, you're connected to so many things that your behavior automatically comes to me, and therefore I know how to personalize engagement and how to touch you, how to give you relevant products, right? So that's the reason it's important. Now, digital transformation. I think if I look at digital transformation, it's really how your customers experience your product and services, right? How your prospects see that you know them. That's the whole idea of digital transformation, every touch point. Today, we have this perspective that who owns the customer, who owns the prospect. I think my belief is that the marketing team actually needs to own the customer experience, because they're the custodians of data, they're the custodians of interaction, and hence they need to have the ownership of this digital transformation in the organization. Now, they talk about the fact that, look, I'm limited to, just the marketing function, and there's a CRM, there is a customer service center, there is manufacturing, there's a whole lot of other things, right? But the strategy for the customer experience and the digital transformation needs to come from there. So that's why we have, organizations today, which didn't exist 5 years back, chief digital officer. Now, does it belong to CRM side of it? Does he belong to the service side of it? Does he belong to the marketing side of it? Doesn't, right? He's the custodian of customer experience. So I think the path to digital transformation is making sure that every touch point of your prospect, of your customer, he gets the same experience. And today, technology exists for you to be able to achieve that.
That seems like a very interesting definition of digital transformation. What I hear from you is it's about putting customer in the center and being sure there is unified experiences for every kind of a touch point. Interesting.
Absolutely.
Biswadeep, as somebody who's leading the IT cell for Hero FinCorp, do you think companies are collecting enough data? Are they storing it well? Are they using it well? Or it's still like Excel files flowing all over the place?
Frankly speaking, of course, everyone would believe that there's a lot of Excels around, and there are people who still believe working on those Excels and kind of relying on data that is available out of a system. So they keep on double checking whether is it matching with my Excel. So I still wonder why they do that. But essentially, my role essentially defines how I make them believe in terms of the data that we are presenting to them. How efficiently they are using the data. There are various facets to what digital transformation may look like within an organization. It could be a customer-facing digital transformation and also a process-related digital transformation. Mm-hmm. What we are focusing currently is more from a process perspective. We are kind of a 5 to 6 years old company as of now, so it's too early for us to kind of look at the entire gamut of digital transformation as a process. But as I said, transformation can happen in terms of process automation. Mm-hmm. There are the likes of RPAs, AIs, and ML that have kind of transforming the businesses in terms of the way they operate. So it's more of in terms of how we adopt these processes across various aspects of probably a customer servicing aspect or a data consumption or insights. So it's the way you look at it.
Sure. Ashok, this question is for you. You know, we keep hearing about AR, VR, augmented reality, virtual reality. Is this real or just fluff? You know, just today I heard a story about Mahindra Auto launching a augmented reality showrooms. Is this now real? Is this technology going to become real?
23rd of May was a counting day for the elections.
Right.
And I spent close to 4 crores investing in technology on my TV channel to actually use AR, VR to actually showcase. And we did that. We actually brought in state of our technology. We thought we were ahead of the times, and we realized that there are 4 other TV channels who did the same thing. So, I don't know if that answers your question. So, I think these are real. These are things which are catching up very fast.
And a lot of us are actually realizing that we need to keep pace with the technology, and the investments have to keep pace with the technology. I don't know whether it made a material difference to the way the results went. Probably did not. It certainly didn't make any major impact on my TV ratings for that day.
It did?
It didn't.
It didn't, okay.
But probably could also be because it wasn't unique. When we did it, we thought it was unique. We realized
everybody
that
was doing it.
Four others who also did the same thing. But I guess if we had not done it, then you know we would have probably regretted missing an opportunity. So I think, and the fact that we had an opportunity to hire this at 50 lakhs and buy it off at 4 crores, and we chose to buy it off.
Okay.
And so that, you know, we can keep using it for other shows and so on. So I think these are things
it's
which
kind
are,
of real and kind of
yeah, that's right.
going to take
yeah.
place. I see. Nitin, while looking at the future of digital, I mean, what's your view on robotics? Are we all going to lose our jobs in a few years and just maybe the next big panel discussion in 5 years, just like robots talking to each other?
Well, I should be the first one to get extinct then. Because sales, you know, today we have AI, which looks at behavior. And just to give you an anecdotal perspective that our co-CEO, you know, has a 6% margin in terms of the prediction of where we will be every quarter, every year in terms
okay.
of the, yeah? And AI has 1%. So, I think because of the amount of data that we have and the algorithms are improving, certainly AI has its place, but the ability to use AI, the creativity aspect of how you deploy AI and making sure that the use of AI is ethical, it comes with trust, I think it's a long way to go. You know, but I would say that today, you know, Salesforce across its platform, whether it's related to marketing, so what's the next best offer? What is it that we do in terms of channel optimization? Like you saw an example of, you know, our Einstein getting deployed in one of the journey builders, and it suddenly says most likely to buy, less likely to buy. So, you know, those kind of things makes the process efficient, brings in automation, that's good, right? In terms of customer service, right? What customers are at the brink of attrition? We see this internally on our, you know, on our system that what customers are not using the product, what customers are likely to attrit, what customers are actually going ahead and not utilizing the full functionality, and we then proactively work with them. So AI is real. Then on the sales side, I have the ability that my team might be saying that, yeah, it's going to happen, it's going to get done, and all of those things, but AI tells me that these type of industries take longer to decide, these type of opportunities take longer to decide, or this type of opportunity is faster, closing faster, or the fact that there's a news article that there's an impact on that particular industry or that particular organization, hence it's unlikely to close. So that, you know, the AI gives me the ability to charter through this uncertainty in a much better way. So it's important, it's real, but I'm not getting extinct as of now.
So you're seeing a lot of value coming through AI, through robotics?
Oh, absolutely.
And
I
a lot of security down the line as well.
Frankly, Hareesh, I would tell you that 5 years back, it was an esoteric subject, and today it's been democratized.
Okay.
So I don't think that there would be hardly any organization which would not understand that there is AI or they won't be using AI. Even on our devices, you see cameras coming out with AI intelligence to improve photographs, right? Right. It's being democratized across all, you know, interactions that we have today.
Ashok, a view on that?
No, just one point, and this is a lesson learned for us also, that while we invested in the technology, we realized that there's absolutely zero skill or knowledge to even use it to its full extent or operate. We had to actually bring technicians from Singapore to run it. And we realized that it's like you know, in those days we used to have these fancy stereo systems which had a lot of buttons but hardly used. It's
right.
a bit like that, you know. There's a lot of features, but I don't think we have the soft skill yet to be able to get full leveraging of that.
Jaibeer, do you have a view on AI and robotics? I mean, how do you see it?
examples was, for instance, you know, the entire thing is how are you engaging the consumer? Because you have to get his attention. All these technologies are going to enable you to get that engagement, get that disruption. But so far, I feel it's very early stages. The usage is not much. As Sir said, soft skills are not there. We really don't know how to sort of, you know, use them and convert them creatively into something more engaging. So
I think it's still early days, and we'll need to see a lot of adoption kind
from a communication point of view. I think it's still very early days.
Okay. Sanjay, we hear Google talking about voice search, you know, whatever voice-based internet, like 20% are voice searches. How does that impact brands? I mean, what are brands going to be doing about voice search? Are we moving to a screenless internet very soon, where it will be all a Google Assistant and an Alexa and a Siri, using which will be engaging with the World Wide Web?
So I think there are different kinds of user audiences, internet audiences, and there are some who will likely adopt to voice much better and much faster for a reason. I mean, it's like we've been hearing about all these leaps that, you know, people have, I mean, industries have taken or economies have taken, like India said, you know, we leapfrogged the landline generation and went straight to mobile. In the same way, the next 200 million or so of internet users that are likely to come into India in the Indian internet context, people who are not that literate, but who are going to be able to learn to use the phone all the same, because the basic functionality of a phone usage will be easy. Now, there is information behind that internet and which this same person still wants to use. He can't type in a message or a search query as easily as he can just ask the phone that, you know, give me, you know, weather data for my farm or something like that. And that is something which the phone is going to respond. A more evolved audience, like a city-bred, you know, educated user, might still continue to use the screens for various things, including, you know, text and you know, video and other things. But the larger usage of voice-based applications, strangely enough, I mean, intuitively one would think that we are the urban users, we are the mature urban users, so now we will get our Alexas and Google Home devices. Yeah, we will surely do that, but we'll still continue to also punch in our queries on a text on a keyboard, whereas the new user, the one who is not that comfortable typing and spellings and all, is going to straight away go to voice, and that's where the huge adoption is expected to be seen.
So that's a very interesting perspective. I think that because of voice, actually the size of internet usage will increase to people who otherwise may not be able to type and so on, you know.
Absolutely.
Biswadeep, do you have a view on voice internet? How do you see it evolving?
Yeah, so kind of, I'll give you a background in terms of how we are approaching this particular piece. Hero, FinCorp, typically we started with two-wheeler loans, with more than 50% of our customers being rural, first-time new to credit, who are kind of first-time loan buyers or first-time two-wheeler buyers. And we had huge challenges around the collections of EMIs on a monthly basis. So we thought, why not just try and see what's the impact of an online payment mode for our two-wheeler customers. And it kind of reaped huge benefits to us. Now, when we are moving on to this particular journey of kind of, there you see a lot of digital loan products in the market, and essentially it requires a user to kind of key in, as our panelists mentioned, that he needs to key in the entire information, his date of birth, his name, addresses. There's a lot of information that it needs to be keyed in, and in a specific language, English to be specific. But how do I reach out to my vernacular customers who are kind of very limited knowledge in terms of English speaking or so? So that is where my voice interactivity would come into picture, and that gives an additional thrust to my reachability and creativity. That's where I think this is going to help us leaps and bounds.
So I guess both our panelists agree that voice will help the expansion of internet. And when you look at Google search, we also see a lot of vernacular search actually happening in voice. That seems to kind of concur that part of the story. Good. This was the, what shall I say, the serious part of our panel discussion. Now we'll come to the lighter part very quickly, which is called the rapid fire round. I will throw 5 questions at each one of you and quickly give me an answer, whatever comes to your mind. There are no right or wrong answers. You know. We'll start with Nitin. Nitin, technology improves productivity at workplace. Yes or no?
Yes. Yes, it does.
It improves productivity?
Yes.
You don't see overhead of email and?
Frankly, it does improve productivity because the way you work, okay, it becomes more efficient, so technology does.
Autonomous cars, good idea or bad idea?
Good idea.
Okay. Made to order kits by 2025.
Bad idea.
Scary or exciting?
Scary.
Okay. One company that you really admire and why, besides Salesforce?
Amazon.
Okay, and why?
I think they leapfrog every innovation, and they've been able to transition from where they were in terms of e-commerce to seeing this whole idea of democratizing technology, making it available, simply to everybody else. And it's as simple as swiping a credit card and getting a server.
Nice. And one prediction for the future, 2025, if one prediction you had to make for 2025?
Salesforce is the only CRM company.
You're a hardcore salesperson. Okay, Ashok, you're next. If you had to buy the stock of just one company, which would you buy? Tesla, Uber, or Google?
None. Apple.
Apple? Okay. Bitcoins in place of real currency by 2025. Myth or reality?
Myth.
You believe it's a myth? Okay. 3D printed food, myth or reality?
Myth.
Okay. If you had the opportunity to be the
CEO. Can you imagine me telling that to my wife? I'll get killed, man.
He's not here. You can tell the truth.
I mean, seriously.
If you had the opportunity.
See, this is the hard bit, you know. I mean, there is taste, there is flavor, there is love, which goes into the food.
You come from the creative part of the world, right?
Yeah, obviously.
Heart and love, you know. If you had the chance to be the CEO of one company, which would you own?
Apple.
Apple, fantastic.
I'll tell you why.
Yes, please.
I think it's a perfect combination of using technology and building a brand.
That's true. Great.
Sorry, I'm a sucker for Apple products. I'm not selling Apple, but I really think it's a very admirable company.
And your prediction for 2025, one prediction for the future?
That's a tough one. I hope my son invites me for his wedding.
Okay, Jaibeer, your turn. A business leader whom you really admire and why?
Steve Jobs.
Steve Jobs? Okay. So you have Apple fan next to you?
Same reason.
Okay.
I work for a Samsung company, but.
Aadhaar, is it a digital espionage or genuine inclusion?
Genuine.
Okay. Artificial intelligence, will it bring an end to human race?
No, not at all.
No, okay. Blockchain will replace banks by 2025.
I doubt.
You doubt it?
I doubt.
Okay. And your prediction, big prediction for 2025?
I see a lot of traditional advertising changing into more digital driven companies. What I would call probably ATL with a digital engine.
Okay. Interesting. Thanks. Biswadeep, your turn next. GST, good idea or bad idea?
Good.
Good idea. What is more important for a marketeer, creativity or analytics?
Both.
Both. Universal basic income, good idea or bad idea?
Mixed approach.
Okay. Sure. Android or iPhone?
Android.
Okay, so somebody is the Android camp. And your prediction for 2025?
Probably Hero FinCorp being the brand ambassador for Salesforce.
Fantastic, okay. Sanjay, your turn. Who's your role model and why?
Jeff Bezos. I mean, I think it would have been Steve Jobs a while back, but I think Jeff Bezos is the one. I think he's transformed a whole lot of sectors and, I mean, continues to go great guns. That was my idol. You didn't say, like, who would you rather be?
Okay. So who will win the race, Alibaba or Amazon?
Tough one. I think it's a, There are two parts of the world, they are both conquering, but I would still get Amazon to pip to the, you know, tip the winning point, finally.
Okay.
Yeah, it's still back on
Skype Amazon. Or face-to-face meetings?
A bit of both, I think. I'm not sure. I mean, you definitely need the efficiency of Skype. You don't need to keep running around all the time. But it can't only be that. I think face-to-face is still very much in vogue.
Okay. And your prediction for the future, 2025?
I guess there's innovation across all sorts of sectors, but I think if there's one sector which I believe will probably have the maximum impact will be the currency, I mean, the carrying of money. I think it'll go completely cashless, completely digital by that time. I don't think we'll need to visit banks. There's going to be maximum impact, maximum transformation there.
Interesting. Great. Thank you, panelists, for a brilliant conversation. Can we have a good round, big round of applause for our panelists? Anybody wants to have any questions for the panelists? Anything specifically? Do you have any questions for the panelists? Nothing? Amar? So I'd like to present our panelists a token of our appreciation. We have planted some trees. You have a question? Somebody had a question? Yes, Veer. Okay. It's obvious? Nitin, it's obvious? Nitin says it's obvious. Who is it, Nitin? Yes. We went to Vijaytay together, so since number of years. So as a token of appreciation, we have planted some trees in the name of our panelists. I'd like to hand over certificates for the same. Nitin, that's for you. Thank you so much for being on the panel.
It's a very nice gesture. Thank you.
Ashok, thank you. Thank you. Thanks for really staying back. Appreciate it. Jaibeer, thank you so much. Biswadeep, thank you. And Sanjay.
Thank you, Hareesh, and thank you to all the panelists for joining us here. Everybody, thank you for your presence at the Future of Digital Marketing. I'd like to invite everybody to join us for dinner and drinks. Thanks again, and have a great evening.